Hi, I'm here to talk to you about web layout and modernizing web layout. Initially, I started thinking about this talk mostly because we did some work in the FIBA team, or my half of the FIBA team, which is the play websites, which I'll tell you what they are in a second, to modernize the web layout, to essentially go from our old like float-based layout onto Flexbox and Grid. I will tell you why in a second. And initially, I was like, oh yeah, I really want to give something technical about the layout. And don't get me wrong, there's going to be a few technical things, but I want to set clear expectations a little bit. Is that I realized that half of the work about doing that modernization was actually everything that comes with it, which is mostly like, how the heck do you take a three-year-old project and modernize the layout in it, rather than, you know, the specifics of like, how does Flexbox work? I'm not going to explain that today, for better or worse. But yeah, just to be clear, and what the heck is our project? We have about 60,000 lines of code in our codebase. Our codebase is the code for basically 5 different websites that are available for players and organizers of FIBA 3x3, which is a sport that we're working on, and people can go there to find and organize local events in their area and so on, as well as participate and watch the very pro level tournaments. I think the play side has been around for 3 and something years, more or less. Almost four, Christian says. Cool. Play itself is in 14 human languages, so we have it translated in 14 languages. There's a whole lot of components, like probably more than I would like, but again, that's how JavaScript works, I believe. We also have a modern site in the same code base. So essentially, the code base is split into 2 parts. Play is the old website where you go to find events, and old in that there's nothing old about it apart from it being around for 4 years. People still use it. The new website is a completely different thing. Like, they serve different purposes. The new site is about watching the pro level tournament, so to speak. But the interesting thing with them is that they do share a code base. They don't necessarily share components, or they share some components. And the idea behind that was that as we make improvements in the modern code base, we can go and backport some of the improvements, or more conceptually, the things that we learned into the old code base. So just to give you a clear idea, this is Play. On the left, it's how Play looks on a narrow screen, or it used to look on a narrow screen, like before the summer, before we started doing this sort of work. And on the right, it is how it looks now. So on the left, you see that like we have this rather huge image, and then we have this small title, and then there's this blue button that goes off screen and like the whole thing overscrolls, and you have to click that to see the event. It's not great. It works decently on a wide screen, which is why I'm not showing it to you. But on a narrow screen, it doesn't work as well. And then you'll see on the right-hand side, we have a little bit better signposting with titles. We've changed the whole thing to be clickable, and also we, in how that thing scales, we prioritize the information about the event rather than necessarily the logo. And with those different constraints, so to speak, we can get it to fit on the screen. And this is very important because a lot of that content is user-generated. So if somebody throws in arbitrary content in there, then we have to be able to anticipate that and work with it and ask ourselves what is important about that content. So it was that sort of work that we were doing. Step 0, before you start doing anything like this, let other people know that you're going to do it, which probably sounds obvious to many of you, not necessarily obvious to me, and why I'm mentioning that. In particular, I'm interested in these 2 questions. Where the heck are we coming from? Where are we going? Again, on our half of the team, over the summer, there were 5 people. Ivan was there as well. Yugi was there briefly. Nice, I have people here. I have witnesses. I have been on this half of the team the longest from those people. So if somebody joins the team and I tell them, hey, this thing sucks, it's not very nice. Because you're like, I just joined this code base, man. What the hell are you talking about? Are you telling me this sucks already? And that's why it was clear to me to explain, you know, what are things we have learned, like, as a group, let's say. And where are we going to take this code base next in that sense. And I went and I started opening issues. As you can see, we had 48 open issues and pull requests. I think during this project, during the summer, I ended up writing as much prose, like long form writing, as I did code, mostly just to explain and document everything, which is fantastic in my book. And specifically, what are we doing, or what were we doing? Moving from floats to flexbox, I'll tell you why in a second, using some new layout primitives. Like in our modern site, we have explicit components for stacks of things, clusters of things that can scale automatically, and so on. And also adding focus tiles, underlines, and other affordances. You might think that's not to do with layout, and you're correct. What was important for us there is that since we're making these sweeping changes anyway, we might as well make the site more accessible directly. And don't get me wrong, things that scale better are more accessible anyway. In other words, we wanted to put new learnings into code. In some cases, this was using components directly. In other cases, it was like getting the ideas into the old code base. So step one, go where the users are. Where are the users? We can consider that on a page. Play is quite easy in that regard, because there's two things you can do on the homepage. You can search for events, or you can search for players. Great. Landing page, event search, player search, event view, player view. That's like the main things that people end up on Play. There are more detailed and niche views, like event game category view, you know, like very, very sort of down the information hierarchy. But the main things that people end up on are these things. So that's what we prioritize. Where are the users can also have other meanings, right? Like on what page are the users? On what device is the user? Like is it a phone with a narrow screen? Is it a tablet with a narrow screen, with a wide screen, a laptop, da-da-da? Which language are they on? Again, we have 14 of them that we support like officially. And also, importantly, who the heck writes the content that they see on the screen? Is it hard-coded by us? Is it curated by somebody on the FIBA team, or is it completely user-generated? Because that also has to do with, you know, what we're going to prioritize. And again, I promised you an answer to this question. Why layout? Why is it specific layout that we care about? Because with those questions in mind, layout is resilience. Like, if you can get the layout to scale well, then most of these things work well. So pages, that's pretty self-explanatory. Device is very interesting. Which I might have another one. Yeah, OK, I'll tell you about that in a second. Same with language and same with the content. So for example, down might be up, and up might be down, or more specifically to the scripts that we support, left might be right, if you support right to left. So we do have, for example, Arabic in the languages that we have translations for. Arabic is not an option at the moment on the screen, because we cannot guarantee that we have good RTL support. And this is a step in that direction. The reason this is a step in that direction is that when you say float left, that's going to be hard-coded to left. However, when you have flexbox, flexbox is direction-aware. So in a left-to-right script, flexbox goes left-to-right. In a right-to-left script, flexbox does the other thing. So if you ever wonder why in flexbox we say justify start instead of justify left, it's exactly because of this sort of property of flexbox to be generic over writing modes. In fact, if you had a top-to-down script, because you can have like some traditional Japanese scripts, I think, and like there's some scripts that do that, then indeed flexbox column would be the other way around and row would be the other way around. And this is fantastic, because it means we can write one piece of code and have it work in both layouts. And also, mobile screen size is a lie. You might have noticed so far I have been saying narrow screen sizes and wide screen sizes, and that's because I don't believe in mobile screen sizes. Like, you can... If you have zoom levels, like I browse the web at 200, 250%, I get a mobile viewport most of the time, even though I'm on a widescreen, on a fast laptop connection, and so on. Pixel densities, resizes windows, all of that stuff really changes the context. And so I don't think it's useful to say that, you know, X percent of our users are on desktop or something, because they might be on a desktop and have a smaller window, and then good luck with that. In fact, 60% of our users are on mobile. So that's nice. And why flex and grid? Again, I consider them less quirky. People who, you know, I know people have trouble learning flexbox, so your mileage may vary on that. But compared to float layouts, to me, it's a no-brainer that like flex and grid are better alternatives. Like floats are not meant for layout. Flex kind of is, grid definitely is. Or flex also is, but, you know, for specific things, not everything. They support different directions. And I think they scale more gracefully now and in the future. And in particular, in grid and flexbox, you can encode properties about how things are going to scale. So if you have an image next to a text, like the search I was showing you earlier, you can say that the text resizes, having the text readable is more important than the image. You can do that kind of implicitly with flexbox and with very explicit syntax with grid. And that's what Jen Simmons calls intrinsic design, that you design with essentially the the size that is important to your content by itself rather than trying to fit the screen. To give you another example, an extreme example, I have a very narrow viewport on the left. Probably there's some device with such a narrow viewport. And you see that we try to take all of the word wrap opportunities that we can to make the title fit well and the logo on the top. On a slightly wider viewport, you will see that the logo is smaller than any of the other two. That's, again, because we make an explicit choice there that we care more about the title being readable than, you know, the logo being huge or anything like that. And different people will make different choices. Same thing on the right-hand side. We have ample space, so we can have a larger image and so on. None of these things have media queries, by the way. This is just Flexbox magic. I'll tell you more about that in a second. This literally, if you throw any kind of content at it, it's going to be able to take it. Of course, at some point, you're going to run out of word wrapping opportunities and overflow, but that's fine in my book, as long as you can get this scaling to work well with the content. And same thing with the map behind is that the map can adjust really well to different sizes. As a small parenthesis, I would say try and document any side quests you run into when you try to do this sort of thing. We had one in particular. I was sitting next to my colleague Mikko, and we were looking at forms. These were our forms. These were following the material design forms, the material design from a few years ago. And Mikko was asking, hey, oh my god, is that a text field? And I was like, yes, it is. Fuck my life. And the reason I was laughing like that is that, like, I truly don't believe that this light placeholder with an underline is perceptible as a text input. Different people might disagree. I did not user test that, I will admit. And I thought it was quite telling that while doing this work that, you know, Mikko could see it and say, hey, this looks obviously weird to me. Can we do something about it? I was like, yeah, we have the power. We can do that, sure. Let's write it down at least, and maybe we won't do it. And the important thing with this was exactly that, you know, if we think it doesn't work well for our users, and it bothers us, because, like, it definitely bothered me looking at it for a while, why don't we just, you know, document it and maybe do it? And we did. We changed all of the forms on the site. Done. And they look like text fields now. Now you might be thinking, Fotis, you did not user test that. Absolutely. I agree 100%. You're right. Google Material Design came out with an article a few weeks ago where they described the evolution of Material Design's text fields. I couldn't get a screenshot, unfortunately. They went essentially from an underline with some kind of placeholder label-ish to an underline with a proper label to an underline with a label with a text box around it. So kind of we're back to text boxes anyway. So in my mind, for the effort and time this took us, I consider this very well vindicated. So yeah. That's all I will say about material design's text fields. And then the third step in doing all of these layout changes is try to uncover why these things ended up there. Like, try to uncover the past in a way. For example, it's not useful to say that, hey, this thing sucks. Well, I mean, that doesn't help anyone, does it? But why was it the case that, you know, on mobile, the things overflow? Like, that can happen by accident, but there can also be real constraints that we have in projects we work on, right? For example, those might be technical, like browser support. At some point, we had to support IE9 on this code base, so probably Flexbox was out of the box. Stakeholder buy-in, like this idea that, in even 3 years ago, right, we were launching the site, so we definitely did not have numbers as to who is using it. Not that I value that as much as other people do, but still. The second one was that, you know, stakeholders might not be trusting us as much or might be checking it on their, you know, nice white screens. There might be a different ideology about how to do design. Like, I have a different approach to web layout, like I just told you. And I'm sure any of you have different approaches to web layout. And of course, that can be encoded in the code we write. Like, that will happen inevitably. And the last thing is that time ruins everything around me, which sucks. And it definitely ruins your code. And part of this whole business was trying to figure out that how has this been affected by time, and importantly, how are the things we're going to write now going to be affected by time ruining everything around me? And what enables us in the present in that regard? I think I have stolen that phrase from the LSC book, I think, at some point. I just really like it. What enables us in the present? One thing that enables us is seeing the past. That's wild. But seeing the past and not just saying, hey, that sucks, but also like trying to understand why things happened. buy-in from stakeholders. Like, you know, we have a different report now than we had 4 years ago with the stakeholders. We have numbers that 60% of our users are on mobile. We have a different mindset. Again, we have different people on the team. Like, I have a different approach to web layout than maybe Christian does or Ivan does and so on. We have more people on the team. Like, numbers matter in that regard. We had 5 people on the team over the summer. We had the bandwidth to go back and do that, right? And we have the power, which is nice. And what I was thinking with both of these things is that, like, these are the constraints that we had and the values that we had through them. What can you uncover when you go through the code base like that? And I think the fourth step, do the coding. Okay, coding is done. We pressed the letters in the right sequence and it was done. Build the time capsule. Make sure that people in the future can do the same changes and they can uncover the same values that you had in a way. In particular, I think what you should make easy is make it easy for people to delete your code. You might have very different feelings here, but I feel really scared deleting other people's codes. I feel terrified because, like, the people who wrote the code that I'm changing, they onboarded me to the code base. I see Christian when I go grab coffee upstairs, so, you know, I don't want to be deleting his code probably. You know, somebody has put time and energy into the damn thing, and of course, for me, you might feel differently about this. It's awkward doing this. How can I say it? And so, making it easy for people in the future to delete my code is sort of my own personal way of saying, "Hey, it's fine. You know, you don't need to worry about that. You have other things to worry about." So, how can we make it a bit easier for others? I think separating similar and same use cases is the big one I have found. We've discussed it also on Slack quite a few times, that if you have a function or a component or a class or whatever your method of reusing code is, sometimes you will have use cases that look really, really similar, but unless you are, like, convinced they're the same, maybe don't make them the same function, because if you do, then somebody in the future will have to change one of those use cases and suddenly the other one will break. And, you know, the more dangerous code looks, the less likely you are to change it, the more likely you are to just let it be, it's fine. Let the forms be like that, it's going to be okay. Use components judiciously. This is sort of related to the previous one. The reason we could go in and change all of the forms is that the forms were a component, so I could change them in one place and, you know, see them in other places, update correctly, which can also be terrifying, but in our case, it was a good idea. And the final one, name things consistently, especially CSS classes. One of the things I recognize in the code base that Christian was very specific about, and I know Jarno has been very specific about in our team, is naming the CSS classes the same as the components, such that it's trivial with, like, you know, search and replace or command P or whatever to find where the CSS lives. So even if the whole point of finding the CSS classes is to delete them, at least you know it's just those ones and they're not going to break anything else. So naming things is important. But also more conceptually, like, let's go beyond the conventionally technical parts a little bit, is that leave comments about your assumptions and your constraints. I can't stress this enough. Like, I will show you in a second, I have left extensive bits of code, especially about the layout that I just told you about. The parts where I'm like, you know, we think at this moment in time that having the text visible is more important than the big logo. However, if a few years from now some organizer is angry because their logo is small, you jump in the code and you can see that, hey, are these assumptions and constraints still valid? If they're not, you have my blessing. Go and delete them. Like, perfect. Love to delete code. The second thing I would say, poke fun at yourself. Like, I do that a lot in comments. Not related to this project, but a few weeks ago we had a Hacktoberfest event here in Helsinki, and I had 8 people contributing to a code base, 8 strangers contributing to a code base I'd made. And halfway through it, I hear somebody laughing across the room, and I'm like, what's so funny? And they were staring at a comment that was saying, I don't know, WTF I'm doing. I'd written 8 months prior, and fair enough, I still didn't have any idea when I read it, but it's quite nice in a way to say that, hey, it's not you, it's, you know, it's me, it really is the code, don't worry about it. Feel free to delete it if it looks intimidating. And also document unfulfilled aspirations, and that's something that Christian has done really well, actually. I'll show you in a second. So first one is, like, layout notes that I have left. This is exactly the map and the logo that I showed you earlier. Essentially, I have broken down explicitly how each of these things is meant to scale, because the how things scale, again, is kind of the assumptions, the constraints that you have in layout. You say, this is important, that is not, this scales in that way, that scales in that way. So if you need to change any of these things, here's the instructions for where to, you know, change the behavior. And this is another one sort of that Christian has left in the code base, where we have this really complex caching service that has a specific assumption about the shape of the data. And it even has that, you know, another possibility in place of the parallel metadata structure, which, you know, we might never get to do this alternative universe description, or we might. And in fact, a few weeks ago, we started working on something very similar to that. And then I was reading the code, because I had to, well, change it to the new data structure. And I ran into this comment, and I was like, there you go, Past Christian, thanks for the notes. I agree. And that was really fantastic. Like, it really brought a smile to my face to be changing this code now, because I was like, oh, yeah, cool. Christian said it 3 years ago as well, so we're good. If you forget everything else from this talk, Flexbooks and Grid, they are awesome. Please find your local Flexbooks tutorial and start using it, like, especially for a resilient web and an international web, I think they are the way to go. Dive into your codebase's past if you want. I hope you'll find something nice and useful to you, and make it easy for people to change things in the future for your codebase. Some references. Jen Simmons, that's her talk. It's called Everything You Know About Web Design Has Changed, or CSS Layout Has Changed, where she introduces the concept of intrinsic design. Rachel Andrew has a post about understanding logical properties. Logical properties is the thing I told you about, that, you know, instead of saying margin left, you can say margin start and margin end, and same with Flexbox, justify start and justify end. Elika J. Etmad has a brief primer of web internationalization, where she goes into a lot of detail about, you know, how does the layout work with different scripts and so on. And actually, it's a really short talk, like 20 minutes. So if you watch one thing from here, that would be my suggestion. And also, Yuhis, who's right there, he had a really nice talk called Contemporary Documentation, where he describes exactly this idea of document, like contemporary in the sense of like the same as the time it was written in. So like documenting code that captures the reality of the environment it was written in, which I think matches really well with our experience doing these changes in the code base. And as for me, that's been my talk. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Great talk. And I really enjoyed your points about diving into the history or like the past. But how would you say, in a case where you're rewriting everything from scratch in a new repository, how do you remember to look into the past of the previous project like we are doing now? Well, because we have experience that we tend to make the same mistakes again.
Yeah, I mean, it really depends, because like, if I don't have a good answer to that. So I imagine you still have similar names for what you refer to things by. So like, this is our newsfeed and this is our ad banner or whatever. So you still have words to look by. I don't know if that's enough in a way. I can't think of any other way to do it. But if you can find those sort of terminology that you use in your code base and go look for that, I think that might give you something. But who knows?
Yeah, it's just hard to remember that. And it's easy to think that the old code is just shit, but it's not always the case.
Thank you very much.